Hey, Critical Analysis, this is your video for your Chapter 4 lecture only. So you are in Week 3, and I am going to be using the Chapter 4 PowerPoint to guide us through. And again, all of that is found in our Week 3 folder. The PowerPoints are in your review folder, and eventually your videos will be in the watch folder. So Chapter 4, this is, I think, one of the first really hard-hitting lectures in terms of reading content, because this is vocabulary, and vocabulary is something that if you have a large base, you're going to have a much easier time understanding what you read. There's a strong connection between vocabulary and reading comprehension. Now, that's not to say that if you don't have a large vocabulary that you're going to struggle reading. That just means you need to have the tools and strategies necessary to be able to find the meanings of unfamiliar words. Depending on what particular field you are in, you may rely more on vocabulary than others. I'm thinking particularly like the medical field, the field of education, there's some IT, vocabulary. So every field kind of has its own jargon, and so that will become even more important. So the question I'm going to pose to you as we kind of talk about this vocabulary is, what do you do when you come across a word you're not familiar with? I have students in the past say, oh, they skip over it, which, I mean, that's an honest answer. Sometimes you do skip over words that you don't know. Now, if they're repeated over and over, hopefully you go back and look them up. I've also had people say that they have, just made up definitions and kind of gone on. Again, depending on the context, depending on the situation, that may or may not work for you. The point is, with vocabulary, it's really important to build that knowledge. So this chapter is going to talk about strategies to expand vocabulary, using context clues and word structure, as well as reference aids. Now, I don't know if anyone like actively tries to build their vocabulary. I know when I was studying for my doctorate, they gave me, or to get into my doctorate program for the GRE, they gave me a list of like 500 most common words. Like, these could appear in your test. And so I studied for months all these vocabulary words. And you know how many of those were on that test? 3. But that's okay, because my vocabulary was really broadened that summer and it's benefited me since. So maybe some people actively, use flashcards, word of the day, a dictionary, or whatever it is to try to build vocabulary. So that's one of the things you just kind of want to keep in mind, is that maybe take on some strategies to help build your vocabulary. So once you are talking about vocabulary, our textbook jumps into, well, how do you remember these? How do you remember the definitions of all these new words you're going to be learning as a student? And so one of the first things I talk about is using mnemonic devices. And so whether that's like an acronym or rhymes or whatever that might look like, you might be using those. Think of, PEMDAS, that's an acronym that you use in math, parentheses, exponents, and so on. So kind of the same situation for maybe vocabulary. Looking to see how you could come up with rhymes or raps or songs or little word associations, things like that. That's going to help you remember vocabulary words. Also, again, as I just kind of mentioned, associations, you want to try to not remember words in isolation. You want to associate them in phrases. You want to use multiple, phrases, clusterings, so that you can think of the word and record it in your memory in a phrase. You're going to have better luck with that, as well as with rhymes or sounds. So our brains really like to pick up on patterns. It's easier for us to be able to, identify something in a pattern. So if you can put it in a rhyme, it's going to allow us to remember that a little bit more closely. Finally, it also talks about kind of like this something called picture superiority effect. It's when you associate words with images. And so if you can associate a new word with a picture, again, our brains are more likely to remember that definition. So if you can have a mental image or even actually a physical one to draw it, whatever that might look like, we are going to be better equipped to remember those definitions. And so then when you are, after you've kind of done these things, you've done mnemonic devices, you've come up with pictures, and then you want to kind of reinforce the use of those. Use them in your written language and your spoken language. Look for them in your vocabulary readings. Create flashcards. Use concept cards, flashcards. Speaking of, I like to always promote Quizlet. So if you're not familiar with Quizlet, it's an electronic version of flashcards. This is actually my, he was in fifth grade last year, my son These are some of the examples that he used that his teachers linked him to, but that we studied throughout the year. You know, so he would go in if he had a test coming up and he would look at the flashcards, and these are some of his social studies words he was studying. You know, you click, and because flashcards really are an effective study method, not for everyone. Sometimes I think people think that they have to use flashcards. They're not always effective for everyone. Let's just kind of get that out there. But they are effective for some people. And so it can be cumbersome to carry around, you know, physical flashcards. So Quizlet is a nice place to kind of store them digitally. So using those might work for you. And then using different structures. And this is what we're going to go into right now. Some context clues, word structure, and reference aids. So this goes back to my question at the beginning. What do you do when you come across a word you are not familiar with? Well, the first thing you should do, according to our chapter, is to look for context clues. These are literally what it sounds like. Clues, hints, tips, suggestions, whatever that might be, that are going to help you figure out the meaning of an unfamiliar word or a word that's being used in a way that you're not normally familiar with. So let's talk about that. And this is just an acronym to help you remember LEADS, and it stands for, you know, the different types of context clues, which we're going to go into. So L stands for logic, common sense, just like information that's going to help you figure it out based on common sense. For instance, let's say the word run. A lot of people think when they hear the word run, that has to do with something like moving quickly. Well, yeah, if you're talking about like the physical activity of running, but if you said I had a run in my pantyhose or she is running for office, well, clearly those are not meaning the physical act of running. So common sense would kick in there. They also have this example, the nefarious gangster killed without remorse. If you weren't sure what nefarious meant, you'd be like, all right, I know what the word gangster is. I know what killed is. I know what the word without is. And even if I'm not sure what remorse is, it, nefarious does not seem like a positive thing, right? So nefarious might be like cold-blooded, evil, mean, and maybe remorse is like without a care, without, you know, feeling sorry, without feeling regret. So common sense can kind of help us kick in. The next type of context clue is examples. So sometimes the author will give you an example inside the sentence. So they might use transition words. You're going to see this concept of transition words in this in multiple chapters. So if they want to give an example, they may say something like, some herbivores, you're like, I don't know what an herbivore is, then it says, like the elephant or giraffe, will feed on plants or low-hanging trees. If you didn't know what an herbivore was, it gives you two examples, elephant, giraffe. They could have also said such as or for example. So I like to use the example, ordinary contractions. Apologies. So ordinary contractions, if you were like, I think I know what that is. I'm not talking about a woman in labor. If I said ordinary contractions, you're like, I know what that is, but I'm not 100% sure. And I started to give you some examples. Don't, can't, wouldn't. Those are all examples of ordinary contractions, words we use pretty much on the daily, but we may not label them that way anymore. The example probably helped you figure it out a little bit more. The next type of context clue is an antonym. So an antonym is the opposite or nearly the opposite of an unknown word. So words like however, on the other hand, unlike, those all let you know that the author is about to use an opposite. Unlike the smooth rocks found in many stream and riverbeds, the rocks along the northeastern coast can be very craggy. So if I didn't know what craggy meant, it tells me up here, unlike the smooth rocks. So craggy must be unlike smooth, so it must be rough. I could also use the example of, you know, I want to be a doctor, but I don't like kids, so I don't want to be a pediatrician. I'm going to be a gerontologist. So if I've never heard the word gerontologist before, but I've already given you clues that I want to be a doctor, but not a pediatrician, gerontologist is the opposite of a pediatrician. It's a medical doctor who works with older people. So that's how antonyms can work. So you want to look for those kind of transition words to help you out. Next one is just the author will come right out and give you a definition. They're not going to embed it in an antonym or anything like that. They're going to just literally define it for you. And they can use some punctuation. So for instance, we have commas, the pulmonary circuit, comma, a pathway for oxygen depleted blood to return to the heart, comma. So if I didn't know what pulmonary circuit was, I look inside the commas or just dashes. I look inside the dashes. Or the authors might use parentheses or brackets. Now, if you're a native English speaker, English is your first language, I will say that sometimes native English speakers, myself included, are guilty of skipping things that are found in parentheses or brackets because we think maybe it's like a side note or it's not as important. But if you see an unfamiliar word and parentheses or brackets are right after it, that's a big clue to pay attention because the author is probably helping you out and giving you the definition. Now, if you're reading an intro level textbook, the authors are more likely to be doing these kind of things. They're going to be giving you, you know, the definitions or a synonym or an antonym or whatever the case is. If you're reading an advanced level textbook, they're not going to do this as much because they're going to assume you already know a little bit about the concepts or the ideas that they're writing. Along with the definition, they can kind of give you an explanation. Like if you didn't know what a platypus was, they kind of explain it here. Or they may just straight out say what the word is. No parentheses, no brackets, no commas. They might say something like is, means, defined as. So let you know like, hey, I'm just giving you the definition. Like for here, if you didn't know what a lamprey was, lampreys are snake-like fish. I could have said lampreys are defined as or lampreys are known as. Those let you know that the author is just defining that word for you. And then the last type of context clue are synonyms, which are words that are the same or nearly the same. So if I have the sentence, the cliff was stratified and each layer held several types of colorful rock, if I didn't know what the word stratified meant, I could look a couple words later and it says the word layer, which lets me know, oh, layer and stratified might be similar. So they may use words like similarly, the same as, alike, to let you know that, hey, I'm giving you another way to say this. So context clues are your first line of defense if you have a word that you're not familiar with and the author knows that their audience may not be advanced in the content area, meaning it's like an intro level textbook, they're more than likely going to provide some type of context clue. But what happens if they don't or they did and you're still not 100% sure? Well, the next strategy you can look at is word parts. So word parts are the prefix, suffix, root word, you know, things that you use all the time, but you may not necessarily think about. So let's take a look at this word right here. I promise you, this is a real word. If you're in the medical field, there's a small chance you'll see a word like this or a word close to its length. I want you to try to pronounce it on your own if you want to. If you can't, or if it was difficult, let's take a look at it broken down. Now you might be able to pronounce it better. Pneumonic, ultramicroscopic, silical, volcano, conic, osis, because we have the word parts. And so the meaning of this, maybe you can kind of look and see, ooh, pneumonic, that looks like pneumonia, so maybe breathing. Ultramicroscopic, really small. Silicone, maybe not as familiar with that. Volcano, maybe you're thinking like ash, dust. So what this is a lung disease caused by breathing in fine air and dust and silt, things like that. Like it's a kind of a disease that like miners might have. Now, odds are again, you're not going to have a word of that length and that complexity, but it's helpful to have the strategies to know what to do. So when we talk about words parts, we're talking about prefix. They come at the beginning of the word. They change the meaning. So it goes, you know, correct to incorrect. That's a whole different thing. Common to uncommon. So they change the meaning of a word and they come at the beginning. Roots, every single word has a root, just the basic meaning of the word. Every word has it. Suffix comes at the end. So it changes the function. Not so much the meaning, but like verb to adverb and so on. That's what you could use. And again, if you're in the medical field, you take an entire class that focuses on this, like medical terminology, it goes over a lot of this. Now, let's say there's no context clues, you cannot use word parts. Well, then of course, obviously you're gonna go ahead and go to the dictionary. You know, so dictionary, whether it's a physical dictionary or dictionary app, if you don't have a dictionary app, I would recommend getting one. You know, there's literally hundreds upon hundreds of them out there. There's some that are to your field in particular. In fact, I would also recommend those of you in your each respective field starting vocabulary journals so that whenever you come across a word that is kind of specific to your field, you have a journal of all of those words there. So if you're in, you know, IT, maybe you have a journal that just has IT related words so that they quickly become part of your everyday vocabulary. That's very helpful. So the next couple of slides just kind of talk about using a dictionary. I don't spend a lot of time on this because at this point, I think we all kind of know how to use a dictionary. You know, there's lots of different references in there, how to pronounce the word, the part of speech, if it's plural and it looks different. Now, the one thing I do like to point out, because I still have my adult students struggle with this, is that, you know, you can look up a word, like the word front, for instance, has like 18 different definitions in the dictionary. And I'll have students who still just assume the first definition is the definition that they need to use all the time. Not the case. You have to look to see how the word is being used in context to make sure that you're getting the right definition. And then a glossary is just, you know, a dictionary in the back of your textbook. So it's another reference material. And then a thesaurus. I love using a thesaurus when I write because I am guilty of sometimes finding a word I really like and then using it too much. And so I have to kind of use either just Microsoft Office's version of a thesaurus or actually go and look up, you know, synonyms. So it's helpful to add variety and also learn new vocabulary. Now, the rest of these slides I won't really go into detail on, but if you are into etymology, meaning you really like word origins, you like to know where words come from, you like to talk about analogies and relationships between words, go ahead and take a look at these next few slides. Those are for you. All right, the other thing I wanted to point out was something called freerice.com. This is a site that originally was for vocabulary only, but it has since really grown. Like you can look and see there's a bunch of, vocabulary only. There's a lot of categories now. It was not there at the beginning, but you can look just tons of them. So the original purpose of it and why it opens up to this is twofold, to build vocabulary and to donate to a good cause, the World Food Program. So when you see here, like choose, okay, I'm gonna choose, means select. I get it correct. I just donated 10 grains of rice to the World Food Program. Now it's gonna get more difficult as you go. It's like 60 different levels. So the higher you go, the more difficult the vocabulary is. And you can do this as a guest or you can log in and create an account. It's just something nice that it builds a vocabulary and it serves a really good purpose. All right, so make sure you check out the chapter 4 assignment video. It talks to you about, you know, some of the vocabulary exercises inside your text and skill sheet. You do have an optional, I'll go back in here real quickly. Under the optional folder, there's a bunch of exercises that have you practice using context clues. If you want to send me, you know, complete one and send it to me, they're not for a grade and there's no Dropbox because it's not a graded assignment. If you just wanted to check in and see how you're doing on these, you know, some of them have, I'm pretty sure I already showed you this in another video, but I'm just going to reiterate. Some of them have a you know, answer key down at the bottom so you can check it on your own. Others you can send to me and I can give you feedback. All right. Hope this helps. If you have any questions or want any additional practice on vocabulary, context clues, word parts, anything, let me know.